for 5 potatoes, 6 potatoes, 7 potatoes more. 1 potato, 2 potato, 3 potato, 4, 5 potato, 6 potato, 7 potato more. 1 potato, 2 potato, 3 potato, 4, 5 potato, 6 potato.
A child's chance, the accident of being born in a particular situation as opposed to another one, seems completely to determine exactly how things are going to go for him. It's almost as though the 11 plus takes place 11 years early and takes place at the moment of birth.
Your man! Your man!
Depressed areas. Deprived areas. Since the 1968 Plowden report on primary schools, they have acquired a new name, Educational Priority Areas, EPAs. Schools here need not just the same provisions as other areas, they need extra money, extra teachers. The EPA in Liverpool was one of five selected to study the best use of these resources, to overcome the handicaps that children suffer through decay and redevelopment, poverty, unemployment.
It makes a mockery, really, of this business of equality of opportunity. Ostensibly, it is the same. All the children come to the starting line together. It's the same game, the same rules, same size pitch, but some of the participants are nobbled. It's a bit like a football match between Manchester United and a team blindfolded with its legs tied together. If you take a class of 30 children in this sort of situation, you'd be very lucky if two of them got to grammar school or its equivalent, whereas a couple of miles away in a good suburban situation, you would find that probably 16 would be going on to grammar school. And when you come to higher education, you'd really have to have the law of averages absolutely on your side to get one of them through to university. Well, you know exactly what this means in terms of their life chances, jobs, careers, and all the rest of it. So you get a kind of downward spiral, you know, the thing goes on generating, and just as nothing succeeds like success, nothing fails like failure. One of the crucial periods in a child's life, because of the importance of life chances, of course, before they even start school, there's a great lack of preschool provision in these areas, despite great steps forward by the authorities. And the children at Paddington Comprehensive School did a marvellous job in converting a double-decker bus. And this bus moves from site to site, where groups of mothers are trying to get a bit of a playgroup together. And the idea of the bus is that it acts as a kind of barker for custom, this great coloured bus in the middle of a street, and it keeps the thing going and until such time as the group can start and the bus can move off with a smug expression on its bonnet to take up the cudgel somewhere else.
Without a doubt, the children who need it most are the last to get it. And this is where the Playmobil going right to their doors, parking under their windows within sight of their homes, provides such a marvellous introduction. Nobody's afraid to come. It's a familiar, informal situation. And as such, the parents have responded. Parents, having seen what we're doing, become involved and then may be able to be helped to start their own group.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
It is true to say that parents in an EPA, by and large, haven't appreciated the importance of these preschool years as a time of learning.
That way. Down there.
Children can learn an enormous amount at this age. Their intelligence develops so very quickly, and if it's stunted now, it will never catch up later on. They don't realise this. They haven't seen what an enormous amount can be done for children before they're five, and it is possible for these children to arrive at school positively crippled by the attitudes at home which haven't prepared them for the situation they're going to meet when they arrive in infant school.
And the other side of this, of course, is that this is really the time to nail the parent. This is a good period in which to get parents involved, and we hope that if we can get them when their children are three, we'll have them, as it were, for all time. Another way is to reach out from the school and find natural focal points in the community to exhibit schoolwork. It might be in shops where we could exhibit work all the year round and trying to offer some sort of exposition of what the school's trying to do to the community at large, which in turn acts as a come-on to the parents to take that much more interest.
Which one did you do? The milk one on the top.
Dripping there, writer. And how are you today?
Fine.
How do you like the children's paintings this time?
Oh, they're nice, yeah. They're good, they already do it, isn't it?
Oh, they're great. And those are Christmas. Super, weren't they?
Oh, you had the fishes there, didn't you?
That's right, the fishes. Then they had the trees. And then they had the kites, if you remember.
That's right.
They were really, really good.
Yeah.
What would you like?
And sausage.
What do you have, beef or pork?
Pork.
Well, that was just a bit short of a pound. They're all right.
The butcher wastes the meat. Chop, chop, chop. For us all to eat. Chop, chop, chop.
Gives it to our man. Chop, chop, chop. And then his work is done. Chop, chop, chop.
Well, the EPA project wanted the mounting an exhibition, and they sent a list round to schools of different topics that the children might be interested in following up. And I thought the easiest and most interesting for my age group was the shops. And so we did the butcher shop because it was next door to school.
Good morning, Miss Anne.
You. What's missing off that chicken?
Feathers.
Mr. Ali, where did they put the feathers?
Would you put the feathers, please?
Oh, put them in the bin.
Why?
Why? Because they know can't eat them.
Would you like to eat feathers in the chicken?
No.
You saw the chicken in next door, didn't you, love? David.
I mean, to show a child a picture of a cow and say, well, a cow is what we get meat from and a sheep is and a chicken is. Well, all right, it's true. But, I mean, it's not part of them and part of their life. And that's what's important in relating it to things that they do know. I think they forget it very easily otherwise.
We've really got to make education relevant and dignify the child and his parent. So much of our education seems to suggest to children that it can't be about them. We've got to start from the points which are known to the child in his own life. It's a kind of child-centred approach, if you like, where we take the themes in the child's immediate surroundings, his street, and move outward from there and let his concepts of society grow from there. And I think everything should be embraced in this kind of exercise, his reading, his mathematics, and all the rest of it.
What kind of a house does Dawn live in?
Another element in the community which needs to be fully thought through is the College of Education. We've put an enormous lot of emphasis on this. In any one week, we have something like 250 students working on the project in something like 25 or 30 student teams. Means that if a class teacher has or 8 or 10 or even a dozen students working in the class with them, they can break down the teaching ratios for, say, a day a week down to something like 1 to 3. Individual attention that results from this is quite impressive. It means that these children have an adult, and an almost qualified adult, to talk to perhaps for a day a week, which is quite something.
Them somewhere and you might build them, you know, all the rubbish. And the rubbish might make a park, like we know where the rubbish goes, and the bin manager.
There's a bin man emptied in the yard somewhere.
Yeah, and he builds a park somewhere, and I just pull that park is made out of rubbish.
Yeah. And then they put all the rubbish underneath.
And then what do they do?
I don't know. I don't know. Miss Jones.
Tommy?
Hello. What are you doing here?
Do you like doing that?
Hello. Yeah, it's great.
What are you going to build after you've knocked it down?
Oh, we don't know yet. We have to wait. Yeah. We might build it for about 3 years, yeah, 4 years.
You have to wait that long?
Yeah.
Are you building flats or houses here?
I don't know yet. They might build a new school or something.
Before the project began, it was extremely difficult to get students into downtown schools on the scale that they are getting in. To them now.
And what have we got inside the walls?
It's changed the attitudes of students enormously. Historically, there is a sort of residual feeling in the profession that these are not the preferable areas in which to teach. I think it's overcome a great deal of the fear that possibly was developing about teaching in these downtown areas. They're no longer frightened of these areas. They know a great deal more about them than they did hitherto.
I think the most depressing thing was that nobody appeared to care. It was like being in a dark box and completely enclosed in every way. And I think the EPA scheme has enabled the school to knock a hole in the wall, if you like, and look outward, look at itself from outside eyes, and look outward to the parents and to the people whose children we are taking care of.
Many parents in these kind of areas, on their own admission, didn't do too well at school, didn't probably like it, were glad to get the hell out of it eventually. Now they've added all the mystique and jargon, even more so, more mumbo-jumbo about ITA and creativity and what have you. And the parent often feels at a loss as to how to help the child when it comes to all this sort of mysterious talk about GCSEs and CSEs and so on. Whereas in a suburban home, probably the parent's been through the system, been to grammar school, even to college or university, knows the ropes. But we've got to inform parents about what's going on. A good way of doing this, of course, is to bring the parents into the classroom and involve them in the children's work. We've got a good lot of parents and a good lot of teachers. What we've got to get is lines of communication between them.
Sugar? Well, I think in other areas they have PTA associations, don't they? But I don't know, round here. Perhaps they haven't taken an interest in the past, the parents, until they've actually been invited to come in. You know, in some areas I think parents will go in anyway to see how the child is getting on. But here, I think they've waited to have an invitation to come at a certain time.
Well, you enjoy the work that the children do and the respect that it was immensely different from when we went. Now, Paul, 12 months ago, started biology just with water and a bottle and a core. Well, this was something we'd never even dreamt of doing, you know. As it were, it was something out of a picture book to us. And these are the sort of little things, you know, they may seem trivial, but to take a great part in the learning to a child of seven.
I've been surprised at their interest. You know, I thought perhaps after a while they'd get fed up, but they haven't. And they've helped them, you know, right the way through. Sometimes, in fact, the mothers have taken over and done what the children are supposed to be doing.
Yes.
And you have little ones running around as well. You know, younger brothers and sisters, and I think they're quite nice.
An experiment showing how to wire up a doorbell. Simply have a battery, a bell, and a push button here. And the lads are now got to wire it up. So will you wire it up, please?
You know, you can talk to the mother and the child knows that you know the mother.
Right.
That it's not somebody just Mrs. So-and-so that you don't know. I think it is easier if you know the mother and father of the child.
Well, it's interesting to know how they learn, you know, the thing that you wouldn't think from the school when we went to school, you know, we never learnt anything like that.
It gives the children more interest in their own work to think that someone from home's taking an interest in them. I think they put a lot more heart into the work.
And he knows that someone's watching him. He's really proud that he can do these things, and more like saying, my mum's watching me, like, it's really made up.
That's it. Now, what's the next one? You've got to change your school.
Spread it round. There are some parents who are so busy, who are so depressed, whose circumstances have by the throat so much that it's almost impossible for them to take an ordinary interest in their children. And yet in many ways in these schools, the people we must consider are the children. We go out to the parents because we simply know that by knowing the parents, by understanding the problems the parents are facing, we're going to be able to deal with the problems many of the children face, the better.
I think the children in these education priority areas are potentially as able as children anywhere. You know, I think this is all, you know, must almost go without saying. I think what happens, of course, is that in some of the skills, language is an important one, they're perhaps not getting the same kind of stimulus as children in other areas. On the other hand, they reveal other kinds of potentials. I think the social potential, for instance, and some of the creative potential of children in this kind of area is probably greater.
In Windsor Street, there is so much crunch, everyone treading on pieces of glass. In between the flagstones, there are little bits of grass.
It is not nice living in a maisonette because the ceilings are damp and there will be only one bedroom for our family to sleep in.
The Liverpool project makes its recommendations at the end of the year. It's been an experiment, spreading ideas around in different schools. If the threads of these were brought together, it would mean a new kind of community school that could give hope of change to areas like this, but only if society is prepared to pay for it.
We're not terribly dewy-eyed about this. Despite the splendid work of authorities like Liverpool, society doesn't seem too keen to commit itself to grand new schemes. We live in a society which can spend millions on pet foods but can't afford a bottle of milk a day for its seven-year-olds. But if we are to avoid increasing frustration and waste, it's vital that the next generation must be able to deal with these desperate social problems. A full-scale national programme of community education is, I believe, our only hope of mounting such a rescue operation.